My name's Chris.
And I'm Kristie.
This is the Washing Up Podcast, and it's Botanical Week!
Oh yeah, we're going to go strolling through the gardens of the Bake Off Pavilion and see...
Is it the gardens in the pavilion?
What kind of fun is to be had with some birds and bees and flowers and trees and the moon up above?
I mean, I'd be a little bit worried if there were...
This thing called love.
Oh, well done. I'd be a little bit worried if there were gardens inside the pavilion, because that feels a bit like mould. It's probably not
good.
Not technically the definition of a garden.
Or that the like we're in the early apocalypse and then the plants are taking over. But that said, I don't think it would there. You know why? Did you notice how neatly that lawn was mown?
Oh, it was beautifully
like,
mown.
The lines, like their groundskeeper knows their business.
Exactly. Like, their groundskeeper knows what's up, and what's up is not the grass.
No, no.
It's beautifully flat, like a billiard table flat. It's immaculately done. So, obviously, it's Botanical Week, and let's get botanical, botanical.
Oh, God.
I want to get botanical. Let's get botanical. Let me see your planters talk. No.
I'm here for it. I was just letting you go on for
it. Let me go? Okay. I'm available for children's parties. Anyway, so... kids love a botanical theme song.
Only to Olivia Newton-John hits, though.
Bananas in Pyjamas, I mean...
Botanical. Do-do-do-do-do. Botanical.
Look, it's what Olivia would have wanted.
It is.
Look, all Olivia has ever wanted... Mm. is to have her songs represented in plant song form.
I'm trying to think of now.
I love spruce. I honestly love spruce. Look, there's so many, you know. Let me tree there in your morning.
Oh,
I can go on for years, so we're going to go to the episode instead.
Yes, let's get
so. Look, nobody would make bad puns or any form of tree related. No, we wouldn't start with any plant. Sorry, we cut to Zoya who goes, I need to romaine calm.
Oh, no.
Now look.
Let us have a little laugh at
that. Oh, that's horrible. It's really horrible. Can I just say, I was expecting a lot more botanical puns. What we got was a biscuit pun.
I know.
And like, it was sitting there in biscuit week. You know, Risk It for the Biscuit was sitting there, and it wasn't until Lauren was led there by the hand by Anne for the setup.
What does it look like?
Yeah, it was. I'm going to risk it for you, and looks at her like, "Go on, I know you know you want to do it. Say the line, Lauren." And Lauren just looks at her like, "I'm going to risk it for the biscuit," and Anne's like, "Risk it for the biscuit."
And I didn't have to pull that out.
No,
You know, crowbar it in.
No, exactly.
Anywhere.
Not forced in any way, shape, or form. Mm. Look, just for those who are wondering, by the way, no, we are going to get to the technical, obviously. And yeah, we all saw it. We'll move on. So let's get into the signature first, because the signature is pressed flour cookies.
Look, they're my favourite. When I'm going down the supermarket aisle, I'm always looking for those pressed. No, I get it. It's Botanical Week. It's a beautiful idea, you know, like...
It's Botanical Week and we have to shoot... No, I mean... No, look, it's not as big of a shoehorn as... And I know that, you know, there are some people who do like British Bake Off, although from what I've heard from our audience...
Yeah?
Nobody who listens to us likes British Bake Off.
Oh, wow.
I hear nothing but people talking about how crappy it is, and they're right. And more importantly, this week they did Custard Week. Not a creme caramel in sight, might I add.
Wow, That's interesting. I mean,
look, they couldn't be racially insensitive to custard.
Look.
So it's a step forward. They could be incompetent with their bake choices, but they can't be racially insensitive to custard.
Not with that attitude. Watch them do that. Watch.
I wanted a Doctor Who tie-in where they did fish fingers and custard as like the technical.
Yes. Although I'm pretty sure I've seen that done as an ode on Bake Off somewhere.
Yeah, but I just wanted to like, yeah, step one, crash your TARDIS
through a house, land in someone's garden.
Land in someone's garden, regenerate slowly, ask for fish fingers and custard from a girl.
Say that apples are rubbish.
Exactly. So, and always comment on your teeth. New teeth still coming in. Mm. Anyway, so pressed flour cookies. But what I thought was interesting was they started off by going pressed flour cookies. And then they went, and then we want you to make them into sandwich cookies. And I'm like, you could have just said pressed flour sandwich cookies and saved us all a little bit of time.
Yeah, but I think they were leading us on a journey. Like, you know...
They were leading us up the garden path or even the primrose path. Ha-ha!
Oh, dear gods.
But they had time to make that pun. If they just cut that line, then they could have
made the pun.
What I'm suggesting is more garden puns.
Because we get a lot of baking puns. Now here's your chance to go and rip off all those, you know, Better Homes and Garden shows, which I'm sure are full of
They usually puns. Are. Like, although, speaking of Better Homes...
just avoid the Don Burke puns.
Although, speaking of Better Homes and Gardens, I do have to give a bit of a plug here.
Why?
You can find it on our Instagram story as well if you don't know, but friend of the show, friend in general.
Yeah.
Aaron from last season's Australian Bake Off is in Better Homes and Gardens magazine here in Australia, their Christmas edition. He's done the bakes in that Christmas edition.
Yeah, he's a cover girl.
He is. You know,
bakes in those... Bakes.
Look, he's America's sweetheart. Okay, he will tell you himself, he's America's sweetheart, despite being very Australian. But go and check that out if you want. It's on our story if you want to go and follow him on Instagram. He's very much worth the follow. So, yeah, that linked in perfectly. So they had to make 12 sandwich cookies in an hour 45.
Yes. Now, one thing I love about Kristie, I know we're jumping around. She took that literally. She's like, I'm going to bring you a sandwich cookie. Like, it's got salsa in the middle.
Literally.
And it's a cookie on the outside. She's like, I'm surprised she didn't throw in some prosciutto. But I think next week is cured meats week and we're saving it for then.
I'm looking forward to next week, actually, because next week's chocolate.
That's right.
And we're in that point inside the pavilion.
Where it's bloody hot.
Yeah, like, I know that, I know that, you know, little birdies have told me that bread week was in the 40s Celsius. Oof. Chocolate week is always ridiculously hot, just in time for the chocolate to not set. So, and as everyone has mentioned on the podcast a million times, they have air conditioning, but one, it's not effective, and two, they can't run it while the cameras are on because it makes too much noise. So they have to kill it while they film. So, Rosie gets really close to a "this is my week" claim.
Ooh.
But for different reasons.
Because she is a botanical.
Yeah, this should be good for me. I mean, I am a botanical. And look, obviously she had a decent week. So if you are part of that theme of the week,
yeah,
you're okay.
Look, I'm rereading a lot of Ben Aronoff Aronovich at the moment, right? He does the Rivers of London series, which feature a lot of supernatural creatures that, you know, look human. Now, here's Rosie saying, oh, you know, I work in security stuff, but she's like, I am a botanical. I think we take her at face value. She's actually a nymph of the rosemary bush.
Look, it wouldn't shock me. I also really liked the way they did the cut there where she goes, I am a botanical. And they cut to Kristie going, I'm an earth sign. I know you didn't say those two things together, but great editing to put them next to each other.
But I like how they just cancelled everyone else out. Like, yeah. You know, like, I'm sure everyone went around the tent going, oh, well, I'm this son.
And they're just looking for the right answer.
They're like, no, we just need like a little kind of like cutaway to Kristie to make that easy. So well done.
So Bruno talks about the idea of that it's about the balance of flavours in Botanical Week. And look, that seems true of every week in Bake Off, but especially in botanicals, because as we know, some of the most lethal flavours in the history of Bake Off
are floral flavours. And look at Zoya when she talks about the clove, like sweet clove that she's using, sweet clover. Mm. You know, she's like, if I use too much, it will go bitter.
Yep.
And it's something that I really appreciate about this episode is people didn't go for the usual technically botanicals, or things that you could like shoehorn in as botanicals, like all your citrus fruits.
You know what we didn't
all
see?
All your spices and stuff. What?
No rosewater.
There was no rosewater. Ooh, we've moved
they
beyond.
They avoided rosewater. Now we did get lavender.
Yeah, that's
which
fine.
Was Jomar did lavender in the showstopper, but lavender and rosewater in particular are the two that usually do bakers in because they go overboard on them because it's very hard to control.
Yeah.
So that was always going to be an interesting challenge. Now,
all right, get us back on track.
Now, John turns around and gets all Mr. Burns on us.
Yes.
The spruce moose. Hop in. I really was disappointed. If he'd made a moose, that would have been perfect. He could have done that. The spruce moose hop in. So he obviously went with fresh spruce tips and a hibiscus flower jelly. A spruce apparently tastes citrusy.
That's really cool. It's like, which pine is it? Like, there's pine needles that you can use in cooking in Australia. that give it a, like a lemony, smoky kind of flavour?
It's not the answer, but because I'm now in the Simpsons headspace, I want to go Ponderosa pine.
Okay, it's Ponderosa pine,
of course. For the benefit of this. No, but it's not. There is actually a pine that does that.
Yeah.
But I thought it was really interesting too, because he says that hibiscus and spruce. Now, of the two, he's used spruce before, but he's never used hibiscus. And I'm like, not many people in the world would, if you had those two in front of you and you had to say which of those have you used and which haven't you used.
Yeah.
Not many people are going, oh, I'm a spruce veteran.
But I think if we flip, okay, so in Australia, we'd use hibiscus more because we've got there's a lot of access to it. You know, have a bit of a tropical climate. We don't have like these fucking winters that lock you in and snow you in.
Hey, what is winter?
It's just this kind of mild inconvenience for us getting to the beach.
Yes.
An excuse to pretend that we can enjoy soup because it's cold.
An excuse to pretend we enjoy soup.
Well, no, you know what I mean? Like,
oh, I know what you mean, but that's like pretty
crazy. If you're in somewhere really, like, you should see all the Australians, well, I should say, like, mostly white Aussies, right? When we get a bit of a cold snap, and we did this year, we actually got a
lot
of snow. There was some snow recently close by, probably a few hours from us. So we actually had a bit of a cold snap and we got to do the whole like snuggle up and have your casseroles and your soups and be all like cozy.
Pretend that we're in a wintry climate.
Yes. Our ancestors are just looking at us going, oh, you sweet summer children.
Yes, exactly. So then we go to Zoya, and Zoya's doing a Kona almond cookie with a mascarpone buttercream, apricot jam, and again, that's sweet clover. And the sweet clover apparently is vanilla-ish in its sort of texture and its sort of flavour. I also really enjoyed, and you brought this up when we were watching it, that because they bring their own ingredients and sometimes they get their bottles and things with their names on them. So it wasn't just sweet clover. It was Zoya's sweet clover.
I hope you get to take your tags home so you can like...
Maybe she brought it from her mother. Because again, she didn't have any items this week that she brought from home.
So she's taken her tags along to her mother's house and just stuck them over the jars.
So that was actually her mother's jar of sweet clover, a bottle of sweet clover. And what she's done is just put a label on it and everything is labelled Zoya's so that it gets it sent.
It's like her mother has some expensive art piece and suddenly on the back...
Zoya's Picasso.
Yes!
She's just trying it now. She's just walking around the house, just putting big labels on everything, which is Zoya's, and hoping that they run with it.
Yes, Zoya's Fabergé egg. What if you could try that in a museum?
Oh, that could be... That's a nice try.
Yeah.
Let's walk around. Zoya's.
Look, if it works, then we can send, like, Indigenous people to all, like...
And get their shit back.
Museum and get their shit back.
And get their shit back. At that time. So Rosie then looks at her mixer at one point, ponders it, and goes, I am distracted by my own buttercream.
Look, I often get distracted by my own butt.
Buttercream. So Kristie, as you said, was making sun-dried tomato cookie and mint cookies, herb chutney, and peppered goat's cheese. The idea was that sweet and savoury sort of balance.
Well, it works so well, like... I assume they have them in Canada too, but you know when you go to buy the fancy crackers, not just your plain like Ritz or Jats or
whatever you've got over there, Nabisco,
or like or your water crackers, like when you go up and you get stuff with figs and walnuts, and
fig and mustachio and all those sorts of fancy
stuff because that's got a sweet flavour to it too. So I think it works perfectly with goat's cheese.
And we leave Kristie for now, although we'll come back to her when she goes running through the pavilion like a crazy woman. And by the way, can I just say, this is actually...
This is what us Kristies do.
Actually, at this point, it was sort of when she did it. So never have I seen a pavilion with more sound effects provided by the bakers. Like,
she just threw in a Naruto run with it.
Yeah, as she was running, she made her own running sound effects. And I'm waiting for... The sound effect is Temple Block Riot. It's the infamous... As I run off in the distance, and I'm waiting for the bakers to do that themselves.
You could start experimenting with the cuisinage in there, and what you could do if you're dingaling the like your mixer. You're probably gonna
get dingaling your mixer. You're
dingaling your mixer. I'm sure that's a well, look.
It's an official
term. Look, there wasn't so many dingalings in the pavilion tonight, but we'll get to
it. It was like later on where John was like, when they had to make the illusion cakes, and John's like, this mixer could be an illusion. It's not, I'm using it. But it could be an illusion. Is that what we call ding-a-linging a mixer?
Yes. It is.
So, anyway, we then cut back to the mad cookie scientist, as he called himself, Joma. But the mad cookie scientist was making...
I feel like we need, like, a bolt of lightning and crack of thunder.
But what he was doing was making...
War, rise, my sandwich cooker.
But what the mad cookie scientist was doing was making the technical from 2 weeks ago. It's not that bad. I mean, Joma, yep. There's mad thing. Again, I brought them up last week. I've already brought Aaron up. I'm going to bring Nerman up.
Okay.
Because Nerman from the Great Australian Bake Off has been trying to sell myself and Aaron on this Halloween cake that he's making, mm-hmm. where rather than eggs, he's using blood.
Yeah, that's cool.
And he's been trying to pitch this idea, and it is the most Nerman-sounding cake ever. And I just want to say...
Yeah.
Something like that would make you a mad biscuit scientist. Doing the technical from 2 weeks ago just makes you practical.
Look, you know, maybe he's trying to find a new nickname that'll stick. Look, what you got to do, though, is you got to do what Jamoan said. Is like, no one will take on a nickname that you give yourself. Like, you can't go, so I'm Hot Kristie, you know, blah, blah, blah. No one's going to call me that. You go around and you get a plant. So what Jim Owen did is got, you know, as a joke, said, you know, told my mates at school to call me Demisex God from Hell. And one of them did. And he goes, oh, don't call me that. So they're all calling him Demisex God from Hell. So what you got to do, Joe Mars, go around the tent. Maybe just bring Zoya into it.
Aren't I a bit of a mad cookie scientist? And just, you know who will do it? Anne.
Anne totally would.
She loves planted ideas.
Exactly. She's all for it. And she's got the look on her face too. I reckon she could work that in.
Now,
okay, and she wouldn't say it, but she would get someone to say it. Like, just, oh, yeah. Like, what's that Simon Baker show? The mentalist. He's a metalist. He's metal.
So, Joma goes with...
Anne's the new metalist.
So, Joma goes with a jasmine cookie. A quick Dolce Delicia. Not using the cuisine art this week. He did it on a stovetop.
Yeah.
And he said it was memories of his childhood with the jasmine in the family home. And
look, I love a bit of jasmine wafting on the breeze.
Just wafting on the breeze.
I smelled some yesterday. Oh. We're finally getting a little bit of warmth to the air with the whole floral scents going on, because it's coming up to what we'd have in the southern hemisphere as Beltane, so like the start of summer.
Yeah.
And I smelt it, and it was just that the heat in the air and the jasmine on the breeze.
It was wafting.
Now I want to go for a swim, but all the surf shit, so no.
Yeah, it's also not quite warm enough yet.
No, it's the time when you go in and you kind of lulled into a false sense of security. You get in and your nipples turn purple.
Anyway, then Lauren.
Mm. Your rose cookie turns
purple. Your rose cookie turns, yeah. So we'll get there. So Lauren made me yell at the TV because the first thing she does is, I'm doing this based on a song by King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard.
Great old band.
A mark out moment for a fantastic Australian band, King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. Sure, they were at one of the home bakes I was at. I think it's the first time I ever saw them was at one of the home bakes.
Really? I don't think they've been around that long.
No, they have. 2010.
Oh, okay.
For the last couple of years of home bake.
Oh, okay. I was out of, like, going to, like,
I did live gigs
by that. I was like, I'm in my 30s. I will just look like I'm out of place. These days, I don't give a shit.
I started really late on my 20s. Like, really, really, really late. I decided to pack it all into the space of about a year.
You also studying and being students. We don't have a lot of money.
No, but yeah. One of the things I did, because, I mean, obviously we've heard of them, and I was, you know, there's the song Big Figure Wasp is a really good song. Mm-hmm. There's a great version on YouTube. If you've never heard it before, YouTube, look up Big Figure Wasp and look up Sydney, and there's a Mosh Cam video. The Mosh Cam stuff is all from live gigs, and it's really good.
Question.
Very good. Yes.
What other Aussie songs would you suggest you could do a biscuit, like, theme or a bake about?
Oh, there's look.
Do you think Dead Cat Three Times
would work? Yeah, Dead Cat would work. I mean, obviously, it'd be a bit of a sad one, but that mm-hmm. would definitely work.
You'd need some Powderfinger in there if you're going to go real Aussie.
Oh, no.
TNT.
I don't want to.
Dirty Deeds.
Done with sheep. So that's a great Australian misheard lyric that everyone loves, which is, rather than Dirty Deeds Done Dirt Cheap by AC/DC, it's Dirty Deeds and They're Done With Sheep. Mm-hmm. Am I ever going to see your face again?
No way, get fucked.
Fuck off. Yeah. look, there's... There's a number of two strong hearts, John Farnham.
Okay, well, there's got to be a lot of John Farnham. If you don't know who John Farnham is,
look him up. You're the voice. You're the voice. You will have heard. You're the voice.
Yeah.
So,
Australians were bandits for a good what's it called? A bagpipe.
Yeah, or Darryl Braithwaite the horses. Oof, yeah. There you go. So Lauren does that. I scream at the TV because, you know, a King Gizzard reference is not common. Probably even within their own houses, there's very little mention of their band. And what she was doing was thyme and walnut biscuit with burnt honey and goat cheese filling, which sounded really nice.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Anne at this point talks about the idea that they do get a lot of bees and wasps around. And as we would see in the technical, when you're doing things like using 5 cups of honey, that might be the reason.
Or if you're dancing around like Anne as like she looks like a flower fairy.
Yes.
Like, you know, she looks like just... She would have like a hive of bees just trailing behind her.
All I could think of again was this, again, another Simpsons reference, is when Homer is the sugar baron.
Gosh, oh yeah, and all the ants.
And all the bees come to the backyard and he's going to make a lot of money selling them back to the guy who's lost all his bees.
Yeah.
And then the rain starts and the sugar melts away and he just gets money back and runs off. So this idea that they've got... Not sugar in like any containers or packaging. Mm. They've just got a big stash of it out the back of the pavilion.
And so they double up on the honey.
Honey, and there's this big pile of sugar behind the pavilion.
It's where Bruno and Kyla go during the technical is just out to tend the bees and sugar.
They just make sugar fairies. They lay down. Sugar angel. So this is also where Lauren announced that she might be allergic to bees and wasps.
Look, good on you for baking your fear.
Yes, bake your fear.
I'm sure that's a new therapy.
Probably.
Yeah.
Came
out of COVID, you know, they were very big on helping us all get through mental health-wise. And
that was how.
Yeah, I'm sure baking therapy is
a yes, thing. What do you fear the most, baking? So Chi then came up with a really cool thing because they were doing all the jokes all the way through about, you know, the loves me not stuff.
Mm.
And Alan came over with the petals and she looks at them and goes, this whole thing of, I love myself. I love myself more. I love myself. Yeah. And I love the fact that she slips all this stuff in
just
consistently.
Just this positive stuff, yeah.
Like, it's that level of positivity. I just really love it. And it's all about self-love, self-worth, self-value, and that's really important.
It's a really punk attitude to have and to own, and it's very powerful. Mm. Anyway, go Chi, you rock.
And then she made...
all rock.
And then they made a jasmine green tea cookie.
Mm-hmm.
They had the curd in there and then a jasmine tea jelly.
Mm.
Also, they gave Alan the beautiful tropical flower to put behind his ear. He looked like a beautiful princess.
Wasn't it a marigold or was it...
I can't remember what sort of flower it was, but he put it behind his ear.
Actually, it was a marigold because they're the first flowers I ever planted.
Mm-hmm.
And all I thought they were used for was keeping away ants because Mum wanted me to plant them around all the roses she had to keep the ants away. But I don't understand why she wanted to keep the ants away because they eat aphids and their aphids go on roses.
So your the first thing your mother wanted you to plant to start you off was to protect her flowers.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a very Mum thing to do.
It is a very Mother thing to do. Rosie was also developing shortcuts to get some time back in the pavilion, which was really clever with the petals.
Look, you know, people might have invented baking therapy, but we invented podcast therapy.
We really did. Rosie was using shortcuts to get time back. So she was soaking the petals in the sugar and stuff to make them go crystallised. And she goes, well, I'm shortcutting this because you just don't have time, which is true. Now... She was doing a honey buttercream, blue cheese honey, and rosemary biscuit. She spent a lot of time putting herself into these bakes.
I am just so here for all the cheese being added.
There really
was
a lot
like,
of cheese. And also the weird comment.
You know what they need?
Yep.
Cheese week.
They really do. I mean, look, if the Great British Bake Off can fuck up Custard Week.
Well, just put on Custard Week.
Or put on Custard Week. And by the way, they did not.
Do any custards?
Make them do a creme caramel.
You don't need to. There's a lot of other custard-based things around, like...
Name me 3 custard-based bakes that you do for Custard Week.
Well, you've got custard tarts.
For a technical.
You could probably do something along the line of a Danish or a Gringle, because you've got to have custard in it. What else? A trifle. You've got to have good custard for a trifle.
Yeah, but that feels like when they did Burger Week in Australia, which was the Burger Challenge, where they were testing the whole burger... But They didn't mention the quality of the bun in any way, shape, or form, and it's a baking competition.
Yeah, so do you want them just to make custard for the technical then?
Well, that's where...
Because that's what a creme caramel is.
And that's where creme caramel was a great technical. And also...
Surely there's other just custard-based...
Creme brulee. But what I really would have looked forward to was I wanted to see them do...
But is that creme a custard?
Caramel. I want to see them do creme caramel. Simply because we know that really good bakers in Canada couldn't do it. Imagine what you're going to get out of British.
That's why they didn't do it.
Exactly. That's the point. That's the whole thing. So Rosemary then also says to Alan at this point, when she goes to take stuff out of the oven, because he is so tall,
yeah,
don't watch out, don't burn your kneesies.
See, she is a nymph. She's a Rosemary Bush nymph.
Also, this continues. We talked about it in episode one.
Mm.
This episode continued the plot line of Alan and Rosemary need a TV show or a podcast or an Instagram show for that matter. I don't care what they go with, but those two need to be interacting on a regular basis.
And then the theme can be, it is Rosie Al.
Oh, you're welcome to that. Either of you are welcome to that one. We're not going to sue for the trademark. So we then got John tent wafting.
Yes.
And I love the way, though, that when he did it, it's the first time I've ever seen anyone do it going, I always watch the show and go, why would you don't have to do that. He goes, turns out
you do.
But what I was interesting was he was only using a chopping board. Now, normally they're using cookie sheets.
I know. Because
they're much bigger.
Unless he's trying to, like, strengthen his wrist muscles, like, all that kneading and stuff. He's like, I need to build these wrist muscles. Or maybe he's going to do some burlesque fan dancing. You've got to build your wrist muscles for that.
That could be it. That could be it.
Yeah.
Then we got the sort of the filling of the cookies, which seemed to go fine. But then we got help being scheduled, which I really enjoyed.
Yes.
So, like, Kristie calls out to everyone in the pavilion, I have help to spare in 3 minutes.
And I love that you know, it was Zoya who picked up the help at this point.
Zoya and got help from Kristie and Joma.
Yeah. And they've come across, she's flagged it. And I think it's a nice little kind of like callback to last week when Kristie got help from two other people.
Yes, and it's beautiful the way they sort of have rotated the help. And again, Rosemary at the end of this one got the rotated help as well.
Yeah.
I also love Jomar at this point when they talk about giving it a little zhuzh. And Jomar's like, me? Giving it a little zhuzh? I don't know what you mean. So, the judging. So Bruno said of Kristie's, they looked like beautiful terracotta tiles. Said the bake quality was good, the flavour was perfect, sweet, sour and refreshing.
He's ordered 100 meter square of them, yeah, so he can do his new.
He's got a courtyard.
Yeah.
And Kyla said that they were perfectly balanced. John's were simple but sophisticated, magazine worthy was the phrase they used. So there you go, Aaron. Better Homes and Gardens. Move over. They said they were very baked well.
No, he'll go and do it for Better Homes and Gardens.
they were very baked well. They were baked very well. Let's go with some proper sentence structure, Buchanan. The jellies were great. They were prepared and baked with confidence, to which she said,
I was nervous throughout.
Nervous the whole time. Yeah. I was a wreck. Jomar, they said gentle elegance, understated, good floral foundation. Unfortunately, the biscuits were slightly undercooked, so they had a raw, floury sort of texture.
Yes.
Rosie, they said it was a great use of the botanicals, great honeycomb work, good choice of piping tip in particular. Kyla likes that sort of...
The schwill.
Schwill. But as a result of
that's what it's called.
As a result of the thickness, the cream was too thick in parts. And they also said the buttercream was a little bit waxy, but the biscuit itself was excellent. With Chi, they said that they looked very vibrant. They had a very complex flavour, but again, slightly underbaked.
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit textury. Lauren, they said the presentation was beautiful. The flowers as wings on the cookie was a really good idea.
And Kyla's now got tickets to go and see
King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. No, I could just imagine both of them, and Bruno and Kyla in the front row.
Rocking out.
Oh, that'd be great. So the flavour pairing, they said usually this flavour goes really well.
Yeah.
It's not quite working here. And you can see Lauren going, what?
Oh, look, I had that issue with Lauren. I ordered this dress online because there's like the Witch's Ball this weekend. It's going to be fun. And it was like a beautiful rose-coloured sequin dress. And I've popped it on. I'm like, Chris, do you think this is working? He's like, look, for what you want it for, I just don't think this is it. And
yeah.
That was his nice way of saying, no.
No.
Yeah.
Look, it's suitable for other things, but not for what you wanted.
No. Possibly for just wearing for my own pleasure in the bedroom. No, this particular dress.
Or just around the house.
Yeah, yeah.
Just watching TV.
Yeah, yeah.
So
podcasting it next week. Oh, I'll wear it to the Virgies.
Oh, yeah. Well, we've got those coming up. They're almost here, folks. The Virgies are almost here. The flavour pen was slightly up. The cookie was a little bit thick, and that was hiding the fig, apparently.
Mm.
So
now, did you know that, like, the whole wasp and fig thing is a good thing? Because that's how figs are fertilised. They need a wasp to go and die in them.
Yes.
So every fig you eat has a dead wasp in it.
Yes, they do.
Yep.
Then Zoya.
So if you're a vegetarian...
Bad luck, don't eat figs.
Yeah.
Zoya, they said it was her biscuits were like carnival. And I'm like, what sort of carnival are you attending? It wasn't that carnival-ish. There was like a little bit of flour on it and that was it.
It's, you know what it is?
It was pretty, but it wasn't carnival.
It's the ladies of the upper class in New Orleans who have a little morning tea before carnival, but don't actually go to the carnival.
I saw
unless they go masked and going, ooh, aren't we scandalous?
I saw no beads. Mm? I saw no boobs.
Huh? Oh, for carnival. I'm like, wow, this has gone burlesque all of a sudden.
It's very burlesque. Anyway, Zoya did thank all of her helpers, who then took a big sort of wave around. I loved Jo Mar's little hey.
I like that she turned around and just threw beads at them
because they turned around and said that that they were very uniform. Your helpers have been very good because they're very uniform. And Jo Mar's like, yeah, they are. Yes, and again, beads. The biscuit was nice and the flavors were very well balanced. That brings us to the technical. Now, Bruno said, don't get all tied up in knots. That was his advice.
Okay.
Now, what we have, shabakia. Yep. Also, it's a form of halwa, which is the sort of, yeah.
Let's keep it serious for what it is. Yes. And then we'll halwa shabakia.
So, again, it's a Moroccan bake.
Yep.
Bruno talks about the idea, obviously, that his grandmother was born in North Africa and the market, they made a lot of market trips in France looking for those bakes.
Mm-hmm.
The dough was toasted, ground sesame seed, covered in honey with star anise, cinnamon, saffron, and a rose design. And
now, all I can imagine that is that his grandmother had to take them to the Moulin Rouge to find them.
Yes. Because... Let's
unpack this flour.
Let's unpack it. So they had 16 of them they had to make in an hour 45.
Mm-hmm.
They've got to be formed into this rose shape, deep fried, then covered in syrup. Zoya comments that I don't know what it is, but it sounds cool. And Jo Mar goes, I have no idea what it is. Then when we cut to that bit where Bruno is giving this beautiful description of this amazing background for his grandmother... And the story of being taken as a small boy around France looking for these delightful treats.
Mm-hmm.
They uncover what looks to be a plate of 16 glistening, dripping in honey...
Vulvas.
Vulvas, yep.
They're vulva biscuits. I mean, you know, Georgia O'Keeffe made a living of creating... roses and other flowers that looked a lot like this. I was curious. I'm like, surely these have to be like something that's done for fertility or whatever. Now they are like they're done for Ramadan.
Yep.
But they're also served at weddings. So possibly, there's no getting around it. These are vaginas.
They're vaginas.
They're vulvas.
It's the whole picture.
There's labia. There's clitoris. There's the entrance to the vagina. It's all there.
Now, obviously, as some of the instructions for the bake were being read out, it got funnier. And the problem was the bakers don't know what they look like. And after the way the challenge went, they still didn't know what they looked like. So the reason why everyone was keeping an absolute straight face is that nobody knew.
Exactly.
Like, nobody knew what these were supposed to look like.
Oh my God, you're making labia and...
You're all making vulvas and nobody.
I can just imagine the recipe writer going, okay, so do I say that they resemble, you know, vulvas? And they're like, no, that's too crass.
It's a rose.
They're like, what about a little man in a boat? Like, can I give you that description?
Should I write something about make sure that you pinch the dough up at the top? At the should I do that? Should we knead the ball at the top?
I mean, at least to put there like a rose as if Georgia O'Keeffe had sculpted it.
Exactly.
If Georgia O'Keeffe.
The funniest part
was baking a rose.
The funniest part was Lauren actually made what looked like rose buds.
Yeah.
But they were horrible because they were so thick that the oil couldn't get through. Mm. What she needed to do was actually make something. If they said, make a vulva, I'm pretty sure they all would have got the shape right.
Yeah, and look, you know...
Although, it was quite funny that John got the most perfect one there.
He's like, that's hilarious.
That's brilliant. So, let's go through the process of what they actually...
He's like, I was trying to sculpt them into a penis.
Yes, I was trying. I miscued.
I got an innie, not an outie.
They had to roast the seeds, sesame seeds, to light brown. Now, again, some of the lines out of context were funny.
Yep.
With the context of the bake, epic.
No idea!
I know. So, for example, when Rosie first of all talked about the idea of... You know, the dough was easy, but the spice balance is the trick. And she's 100% right.
Mm-hmm.
The dough itself wasn't a hard make, but it was about the shaping and it was about the spice balance.
Yep.
Then she's talking to Anne about sesame seeds in a bake.
Yep.
And they're like, I like that flavour and texture and I like the nuttiness. And then Rosie's like, don't we all like a little nuttiness? Now, at the time, that's about being a bit crazier, a bit zanier, a bit out there. In the context of the fact that you're making vulvas...
We've gone blue.
We've suddenly gone very blue with the bit of a nuttiness comment.
Yes.
And their laugh is funnier to the audience than it was to anybody inside.
It really is that moment when you're listening to your grandparents or an older relative talk about, I don't know...
I was once at a wedding. Yeah. I'm not going to use names. I was once in a wedding where... The grandfather of the bride was giving a speech and he was talking about, and that was a very sheltered wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that the groom came early and the bride came late when they were born. And he did not know what this meant for their future marriage. Now, he wasn't making a sexual innuendo. Half the room was like, oh, it's so true, or like a little, ha, 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 yeah, they're late or early. And every one of us who was somewhat worldly was on the floor. I had to leave the room and go outside because tears were streaming down my face at the line, he was early, she was late, I don't know what this means for their marriage. I just dying of laughter. It's one of those moments.
Yep. It is. Yep.
So... And then John asking the question, which again, in itself is just a really funny comment about bread week being, you know, last week and stuff like that. And he goes, is the kneading ever over? I don't know. Is the kneading ever over? Can you, about too much detail? Can you work too hard? Can you work too much?
Look, I think, you know, if you're getting your hands in there.
Well, if you're getting your hands in there and like there's a whole series of instructions.
You do need to be mindful.
Yes, you know, you do.
Of the structure and how you... If it gets moister or drier,
especially later on when it gets sticky. Yes. After the basting in honey, that's what we're talking about.
But moving along, because there is more. There is more gold in them than there are hills.
Yes. Yeah, so the 5 cups of honey, as I mentioned before, for anyone who wondered why in bake number one they talk about the number of bees and wasps. Then we have a momentary break from the innuendo illusion.
Yeah.
To instead. The least stressful fire that I've ever seen in Bake Off. So they go, you need to make sure that the honey doesn't, syrup doesn't boil over. Lauren's boils over and starts smoking and smouldering, and you're like, oh no. And then they cut to Chi, who boils over to the point where her stovetop catches fire, and she's like, oh, look at that. And John turns around and very casually goes, oh, fire. And nobody moves. And you can see one of the assistants comes running in with a tea towel and just puts it over the top to put the fire out.
Yep.
But she's just baking and John just looks casually and goes, oh, fire, and no one cared.
All I can think is like, how many fires has Chi set while they've been baking at home?
They're coming in on the carts in the morning and she's like, set fire to the cart.
Yeah. Is their child wandering around with a fire blanket? Like, are they swaddled in a fire blanket because they know that... that they're going to have to use it.
In every single bake in this series, what you haven't seen is they've set fire to something.
Yeah, yeah.
And everyone's just over it by this point and go, ah, It's happened again.
Yeah.
The fire's happened. She said fire to things. But it was just the casual, like, oh, fire. And, like, John couldn't have given a shit. It was like just seeing, like, oh, my keys are there. Oh, look. Stovetop's on fire.
I'm glad they didn't do a Michael Scott.
So, this is where we get to the instructions for cutting and shaping the dough. Now, the first series were basically the equivalency of, like, turn the top side inward, insert tab A into flange B, all of that sort of stuff. Yeah. But then we get thread your finger through alternating strips after cutting the slit. The slit should not be longer than 3 inches in diameter.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure and should be contained with inside the square.
You know, I think I read this in a Dolly Doctor when I was 14 on how to thread your fingers into the slit.
Yes, so it was first of all the 3-inch slit.
Oh, Dolly Doctor's like your teen magazine.
Teen Vogue, yeah, that sort of thing. So, yeah, it had to be 3, and then, you know, no longer than 3, and then obviously you had to put your fingers through the alternating slits.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone's like, what do you mean? And then we got the visual of everybody inside the pavilion holding this dough and inserting their fingers quite firmly through the dough, like thrusting them into the dough.
There are specific people in that tent who I think would have a better technique than others.
There are some people in there who I think if they ever wanted a video to possibly go on a dating site.
Yeah, that could
that work. Clip could be really useful to them. I'm just suggesting something. Mm. Now,
I mean, I think I know what happened to a few people. They used too many fingers.
Too wide. That was why it all fell apart, really.
Hand-fisted, yeah.
Exactly, you know. I love that they cut back to Chi, who's trying to read the instruction and goes, I don't know what I'm doing. And Anne's like, I don't know what you're doing either. And, like, then they're trying to put them all together, and Lauren is just looking thoroughly confused at the whole thing. Going, no, it can't look like... No, that's not how it looks.
Well, they really were 1950s young men about to lose their virginity, weren't they? They had no idea what they were doing.
Look,
though,
it was confronted with the rose. It was the equivalency of the Spartan army. You know, it was the Spartan male the night after his bride capture, where he goes in with the bride for the first time. She had a head shaved to look like a male, because he's in a boy's tunic, because he's never seen a female before, and he has to impregnate her on the spot. And...
wow.
No idea. He's got no clue what he's doing. He's fumbling around. He's looking for something. It's not there.
Is that what happened?
Yeah. So the bride capture was part of it. It was a ritualistic bride capture mostly, although she had the ability to fight back. And if she fought him off, bad luck. Mm. And then she would, for the wedding night, she would have her head shaved and wear a boy's tunic and go into the house. And then he would go into the house after her in the darkness. They would do their deed. He would then leave and go to the back to the sleep with the men in back at the barracks.
Uh-huh.
Because they slept with each other in the barracks as part of the building the trust for the army. And they had no real connection with the females. It was all about male bonding. And so, like, they were all used to the, like, male bodies and male sexuality.
Okay, if I was a woman in Sparta, I'd just be going, where's the nearest ferry to the Sapphic Island?
Well, the women also used to...
like, I'm going to Lesbos.
Well, the women also did get to turn up and watch the Spartan males all train and make fun of them if they were not fit.
Yeah, but this is all toxic masculinity.
Of course it is. That's welcome to Sparta. This is Sparta. You know, no one has ever claimed Sparta. Oh, sorry. Incels have claimed Sparta to be the greatest civilization that ever lived. We all just know it is a really horrible place. But yeah, that was Sparta. That's the history corner. Anyway, moving on.
Well, what are we talking about?
So. They then get to the frying
labia cookies.
They then get to the frying bit, and Alan goes, are you excited for the frying? And Lauren's like, no. Hot oil. Bare arms.
Ow. Oh. Ooh. And it's hot. It's not like you'd consciously go, I better wear long sleeves. Mm. You'd be like, I need to stay as cool as I can in the tent, not I need to protect myself from spitting oil.
And the oil had to be exactly 315 degrees. Oof. Then when you took them out, and this was the thing that I was amazed they didn't spend more focus on. When you took them out of the boiling oil, you had to instantly soak them in hot honey mixture for 5 minutes and then put the seeds on them. So when you're pulling them out, you've got hot labias. Well, they should be labias, but they weren't. Hot labias coated in boiling honey with sesame seed, that's going to stick to your hands and burn, and you can't get it off quickly.
Mm.
It's not a good time. None of it sounds like a good time.
What, being hot, sticky, and nutty?
Not while you're burning, it's not. but see, it made me flash back to...
If you're burning, you've got to go and see a doctor about that.
And, but the look of it, especially because nobody really managed to make them look right.
No.
It reminded me of when I was at university, we went to the casino once. They had a really fancy Chinese restaurant at the casino. And we ordered a big group meal. And we ordered honey chicken. And it was like, coated in honey. It looked a lot like this because, you know, none of this looked like it should. Coated in sesame seeds.
Yeah.
But it had congealed.
Oh, no.
And the fork was put into the plate.
Oh, no.
And it had congealed so badly that I could pick the plate up over my head.
Oh, no.
Exactly.
Oh,
and
no,
spin.
No, no, no,
spin
no.
The plate around my head with the fork and nothing moved.
Do you think it's the same plate of honey chicken they just serve everyone?
They never have to,
They just send it back. Put it on the shelf.
Got them again.
When the white people come for their honey chicken.
Got them again, folks. Then we got Rosie, a little excited, dancing. And then that's time. And Rosie bangs on the desk excitedly and a little shuffle dancing. It was brilliant. Now, of the plating, and we'll get to the judgment in a second, but my favourite part of the judgment was it said John was the only one who really produced one. Now, what I enjoyed about the way
that
it was
plated... And he
was
probably a bit embarrassed and hid it because he's like, oh, that one looks a bit labby-alike.
Well, what I enjoyed about the way that it was plated was that John's one was in the middle of the plate. And then the rest of them were all wavy. So it was like it was like pubic hair. And it looked like John's plate needed a trim. Because he had the one perfect one in the middle, and then pubic hair everywhere. It was great.
I'd hope for that honey to get a bit more congealed, and he'd have a perfect waxing.
I just ripped them off the plate.
Yeah, pop it
so the judgment. Yeah. Christie's had good colour. They were missing the flower. Everything. It wasn't a flower.
Go on. Yeah. I can't.
They said that you must cut inside the frame. It's good advice there, people, for everyone. Good flavour. That's about trimming. Cut in the frame. Good flavour, but lacking the honey sweetness. Mm-hmm. John, the middle one, had the shape, as we said. Some were fried well. Some were lacking in colour. The flavour, though, was well balanced. Cheese had great shine. Was cut too deep, though. Some were very crispy. Some were more heavy, and some had seen too long in the oil. Mm. Lauren's looked like it was pinched and twisted.
Oof.
I mean, depending on what your perspective is on that. Lucky. But the glaze was good. The frying was difficult because it was a ball, so it was raw in the middle.
Yeah.
But
hers looked like roses.
They actually look like actual roses, yeah. Zoya said it was one step away from the perfect shape. Dark looking, but on track in terms of the flavour.
It just needed an labia minora.
Yeah.
And she's the only doctor in the room who could have probably...
worked it out.
If they'd have said, make it into a labia shape... Hers would have been fucking anatomically correct.
Jomar had been cut into strips and then formed. It was very doughy, and there was no star anise or cinnamon.
Oof.
Rosie, they said it was the wrong shape, but great texture, good flavour, and everything else was there. So in the judging, it was Jomar, then Lauren, then Kristie, then Chi, then John, then Zoya, and then Rosie!
Woo!
Okay. That's a win. That's a win for the washing up. Yeah. The washing up wins the technical.
Look, we love all the bakers, but you know, we've known Rosie for a few years.
We've known Rosie for a while, so
she's part of the fam.
That's a win. That's a win
and
for
I
us.
I had no idea she was a nymph. So
yeah, that's a win for us. We'll take that one. Now the showstopper.
I presume she's friends with Liam. You know, he's the call him? The things with the hoops. A fawn.
Yes, he is a fawn. Liam's definitely a fawn. All right, so
the showstopper. He goes.
It's Wally got a full turkey on his back. Anyway, the showstopper, the illusion cake.
Yes.
Now, Series 5 Australian Cake Week.
Also did an illusion
that
cake.
That was the showstopper. Was.
But I like this as a choice for Botanical Week because what an opportunity to show off the different ways that you can make plants, like bring botanics into your bakes.
Yes. Four hours to make your botanical cake.
Is it a plant that Kristie made die? Is it the birthday cake I made you? Like, obviously, I don't know what a living plant looks like.
No. So, Zoya said that it's always a bit nerve-wracking making stuff look like other stuff. Technically, Zoya, that's baking. You're making flour, and eggs and everything else look like cake. Technically, everything you do in baking is making stuff look like other stuff. So I'm a bit worried by that sentence.
Well, we know that her, you know, she really has a passion for being a doctor, right? But she's...
I thought you were going to say she has a passion for taking things from her mother's house.
And that too. But in order for her to keep getting away with taking things from her mother's house, she has to follow the path her mother obviously set her on, which is to be a baker.
Yes.
So she gets nervous every time she's turning something into something else.
Because all she wants to be is a doctor, but her mother is desperate for the baking credentials.
She's like, I've told all my friends you're baking, and you're going to go and like embarrass me by becoming a pediatrician.
Stop it!
Okay. You'll be dealing with children, saving their lives.
So,
nurturing families, creating a better generation for all, and...
How dare you? All I wanted was cake! So, Rosie made African violets, like a three-pot African violet tier. Grapefruit and bergamot cake with fondant petals and chocolate leaves. And was going for the whole defying gravity of the stacks of pots. And I love where she goes to Alan, you know, the stacks of pots that people have at their front door. And he goes, I've just got sneakers.
Stacks of sneakers.
Never have I seen a more obvious difference between the generations.
Yes.
You know, and look, African violets were really big here. Oh,
fucking
everyone,
the 80s.
Everyone had African violets.
And they had them in the bathroom because it's the best place to put them, by the windowsill in the bathroom, so you can get all the steam on them.
Oh,
now
lovely.
I'm sounding like Mel Buttle.
You really are.
Her mum. Go check her out.
Yes.
Mel Buttle doing her mum impersonation. Yes. Great.
Then Kristie gave us the most deep sentence that I think we've ever heard on Bake Off that nobody noticed.
Felching.
Not you. Her comment about, I'm here, I'm just multitasking, I'm just reflecting on hypercapitalism here by doing many things at once. And I absolutely loved the fact that we got this little reference to the fact that, you know, hypercapitalism is eating us alive and making us all burn out by doing far too many things at the one time.
No, I don't know what you mean. While I'm sitting here podcasting and betting on stocks and trying to do all the housework and be a good cat mother.
Exactly. No, I love the fact
that... I want to be a woman who has it all.
I love the way that she got that little dig in on hypercapitalism. It was just
nice.
Mwah,
nice
chef's kiss. Last, you know, the other week with the graffiti art in the laneway, you know, where Alan asked the question you shouldn't ask of, have you ever held a spray can? No, Alan, don't snitch. This week, she's commenting on hypercapitalism. By the end of this series, she's just going to be bringing the system down.
Yes. We like
she's just going to be backing club. She's just going to be backing GameStop in as a stock and trying to take the money from the high end of Wall Street. Now, John decides he's going to make a pineapple illusion cake. Good news, he used real pineapple. He wasn't forced to use doll packets like New Zealand.
Thank God.
Now, coconut rum and pineapple filling and ermine cream. But once again, let's talk about the most important part of this cake, rum. So John has, and they even brought it up.
It was a dark rum too.
John has made a habit of boozy bakes.
Well, he's taken note, obviously. What's one thing that we've said consistently through this podcast?
British Bake Off sucks. Oh, you mean of this?
Boozy bakes.
Boozy bakes always win, and you can see, the second they mentioned booze this time, Bruno's eyes lit up, Kyla's eyes lit up, and when I got to the judging, the first thing Kyla said was, I hope there's a lot of rum. but it's...
Because
there's
she
always,
likes pina coladas.
Look, I'm going to say straight up.
And her cake's like pineapples.
I would suggest the Virgie Committee is going to look very fondly on John.
With boozy bakes.
For the boozy baker. I just have a feeling that they're already...
He is the...
They're already... They're already there. They're already putting his name on an award. So, I'm distracting and I'm feeling here because I don't want to... Zoya's been gotten to.
She has. Look, we here at The Washing Up have been burnt in the past by...
Big Berry.
Big Berry. You know, these berries that have crazy names that just suddenly pop up.
Look, it began with the Saskatoon berry.
It does. It did. And
then there was the sea berry.
Oh, my God.
Not real. Definitely not real.
And then who was it out walking? One of the Canadian berries. Larry. Larry was out walking. What did he see? Some random berry?
Yep, another one of those.
Oh. I'm like, that's bullshit.
This week, out of absolutely nowhere, no reference, no lead-in, Zoya just produces a Hascap berry.
You know
what? I'm sorry. This is just a lie.
Look, I think we need to harken back. If you're going to start pulling in rando berries like that, we need to harken back to the early days of Sue and Mel, who would be sent off to some place in the middle of Europe to talk about dumpf noodle. You know,
exactly.
The history. You want to prove these fucking berries exist? Take us to where they...
Give us a tour.
Give us
take
a tour.
Take us out there. Show us
the history.
Show us they're real.
Mm.
Right, show us they're real. Because I, again, Big Berry is in there and they are infiltrated. Now, this is personal.
Like
Big Berry is just doing this to personally attack. I feel shamed and hurt.
Point on the dolly where Big Berry hurt
me. Big Berry hurt me all over the dolly. All over the dolly. But then I was balanced out by the fact that, and again, Canadians, you may not get this unless you've ever seen episodes of MasterChef Australia, but the Australian audience out there who listens to us. So the terrarium that she did was a terrarium for Nathan. Now, there is an image. I will put it out on Twitter and I'll put it out on Instagram. One of the series of Australian MasterChef, there was one of the contestants had been in the show previously, didn't quite make it, came
mm-hmm.
back in another series,
mm-hmm.
and was there to do it for her son Nathan. And what she served was a parsnip across a plate,
mm.
and in tomato sauce she wrote, "For Nathan."
That was the dish. Like, she had a bit of a cock-up. Like,
so everyone looked at this bake in Canada and saw the terrarium for Nathan and went, "Oh, terrarium, look at that, isomalt. Oh, my God, look at what she's making. She's got a chocolate espresso cake with buttercream succulents around. This is going to be amazing."
Chris and I are just sitting here waiting for her to pull out the jam, pop it in a bloody, like, you know, piping bag and write, "For Nathan."
Just put a parsnip across the plate.
Parsnip, yeah, next to it.
So I lost it at that point. I was angry at the Hascap berry, and then I was thrilled with For Nathan.
So thank fuck they evened it out.
They balanced out.
They're psychologically fucking with you, my
Saved me. Saved me.
Yeah.
So Joe Ma was going with lavender buttercream, chocolate ganache, devil's food chocolate cake, and was making one of those mini gardens inside the planter. And like Kyle later, which is like, "I have that planter."
Yes.
I've seen that planter before, the box one with the...
Oh, yeah, they're around.
Yeah, and look, his piped cactus in particular,
lovely.
He piped beautifully. The top of it was amazing.
Yeah.
The issue came with the layers and the fact that he had more cream and stuff like that than cake, and it was really out of whack. Now Lauren made a squash garden.
Oh my God!
Now there was a chocolate chai ganache, mm-hmm. candied pumpkin seeds, and she used kabocha squash. I love kabocha squash. It's hard
That's
to get
the
hold
Japanese
of.
One, isn't it?
Sweet. Sort of Japanese pumpkin.
Ooh,
it's a
yum.
Bit sweeter.
Mm.
Absolutely loved it. And again, like then she made the little mini one off to the side as well. And just...
I wonder if it's like that pumpkin. Remember, I came home from this kind of like organic market with this jar of what I thought was, like what I initially thought was peaches, but was told was pumpkin. And it was like sweet peach.
Yeah, I think it was. Yeah.
But it was like a Eastern European thing.
Yeah.
And she'd smuggled the seeds into Australia.
Yes, had to smuggle them in. Now, then we go to Kristie's bonsai. So first of all, I'm going to say straight up, amazing quality on that bonsai. It looked incredible.
Mm-hmm.
But the initial phase looked very much like a police raid in a nightclub at about 11 o'clock. They've lifted up the cistern and they've taken a bag full of green slimy pills.
Out of the cistern.
Oh, out of the cistern.
I wouldn't know anything about that, my love.
Neither would I. But,
I mean, you had your year of...
I had my year of living. Not even dangerously, just living. Now, was it leaves on the bonsai? Was it the hall after a police club raid? You be the judge at home. That's your decision to make, not ours. She did make a chocolate beetroot cake with the tea buttercream as well. Hang on a minute, I just knocked my cable out of my laptop and I don't want to do that because I want the podcast to actually keep going.
Excellent.
So, and this is how you know we don't edit, folks. now, she went with a salad cake. What I really appreciated was bringing the lettuce in to actually then mould
yes.
the lettuce from.
But she's pulling out the lettuce, I'm like going, holy shit, is she going to, like, flavour the cake with lettuce? Is it going to be a lettuce?
And then she literally put the lettuce down. And just starts... And then did the paper with the lettuce. It was just amazing.
Like, tracing. Like, when you're a kid and you get taken to it, like, on a school trip and you've got to do the tracings on the...
Yep.
Either bark or memorial stuff.
Or coins if you're really bored.
Yeah. Or when we were girl guides, an old convict cemetery. Just...
There you go.
Because that's what you do.
As you do. Almond
very
sponge,
respectful that.
Almond sponge and a blackcurrant mascarpone mousse hiding the cake inside of this salad, which was just superb. What the quality of the blueberry. I did find it interesting that she had lettuce and all of those sorts of things and then blueberries and strawberries and all of that in the same bowl. It was an interesting salad.
Well, you know, she couldn't tell which kind of... Like, she's like, what salad?
The cheese.
I'm surprised there weren't some walnuts in there. It's like, there's a Waldorf.
We're fresh out, of Waldorfs. now, then we had, again, back to Rosie again, and this time was far more important because Alan was asking about his file. And all of the bad jokes that he's ever told her on this file. And then later on when they came back for round...
In a heavy laptop.
Yeah, when they came around for...
I was surprised she didn't go, we have a whole server full of your shit jokes, Alan.
And then when they came back around again, he's like, so I've got some more material I want to try out on you. And she goes, I've got to do a credit check first. Is that going to be okay? And he just walks away. Then we got to the assembly of the cakes. Now, there was lots of fondant. I'm not usually a fan of a massive amount of fondant. I get where you need to use it, though, in this situation, because you're trying to make it look like something else.
Yeah.
And the good news is, you know, it's not like, you know, where a lot of people use fondant, which is, you know, we've talked about it before, vanilla cream, vanilla buttercream and Rice Krispies.
Yeah.
There were actual cakes under these.
Absolutely. And, it, you know, we know the showstopper is about prettiness and decoration and whatever else, as well as the flavour. Like that.
Yeah.
As what happened to poor Joma, you know, you got to have some...
the balance was
the balance of, you know. Anyway, what was I talking about? Something dark side.
Fondant, use of fondant, make it look pretty.
Yeah. Is that you can use whatever you need as long as it's edible. And everyone chose tools that suited the purpose.
Yeah.
That's what I wanted to say. Yeah.
So then we go back to Rosie. And
like, it was brand cereal.
Exactly. Now, Rosie was very...
Isomalt.
I've decided that Rosie's very
tomato
much...
Tomato sauce to write someone's name in.
I've decided that Rosie's very much like a 20s blues singer, but she's far more upbeat about the singing of her troubles. Because, like, she's singing about things that are going wrong, but she's singing it in a really upbeat way.
she made it very
Why
light.
Did I think this was a good thing to do? But it was very bright and cheery.
It's a very new age approach to stuff.
Now we got to the end. As we got to the end, Rosie was desperate for help. Kristie and she came sprinting over and managed to help balance like the plants and sort of finish off the last part of the leaves.
Yeah.
And again, we talked about that last week with Kristie getting the help at the end. And again, I don't have a problem with it. The question last week was about Star Baker and that. For Rosie, she'd had a decent week. She wasn't going to go home, but she also wasn't going to be Star Baker. So an issue.
Yeah.
All right. So the judging, Lauren, they said it looked stunning. Bruno just said straight up, he goes, that cake is amazing. Mm-hmm. He goes, it is so beautifully balanced. It is so light. It is so delicate. The texture was perfect.
It's so cakey.
And the candied seeds inside.
They were fucking phenomenal. Like, just...
Whole thing looked great.
Yeah.
Zoya, they said it looked great. The piping was really good and there were very even layers. They said the berries were the star, so they've been got to by Big Berry as well. they said as well that the balance with the chocolate is really good. The jam was also really good. So everything worked out for her. Kristie's, they said, was a work of art. Had absolute beautiful flow on it. It had everything you would expect from a bonsai. They said, including the soil and the rocks down the bottom, which were perfectly replicated.
She was there trying to have to, like, kick the ghost of Mr. Miyagi.
Wax on.
Wax off.
They said a very even distribution with it. The cake was light and earthy, and the raspberry hit, which was a very minor raspberry hit, was just enough. Chi, they said that it looked like a Dutch still life painting, which I agreed with 100%. It looked like one of the masters would have painted that. the detail was perfect. The lettuce was crisp.
I think it was a Cezanne.
Yes.
That's who
Very a Cezanne.
Yeah.
The lettuce was crisp. When they cut into it, you could hear the crunch.
Yes.
Good almond flavour. The texture.
You know why it was crisp? Because it was wafer paper.
I was wafer thin.
Wafer thin.
An excellent cake. Joe Mars looked natural. Kyla said she had that planter. And again, that piping on top of Joe Mars, the falling sort of leaves and stuff, was unbelievable. Unfortunately, the cake was very dense The texture was thin but good, and the problem was the density was there was too much of an imbalance between cream and cake. Mm-hmm. Rosie, they said the concept was really clear, mm-hmm. and it was remarkable in the time. The texture of the leaves was great. They were chocolate leaves because they cracked when you cut them.
Yep.
The cake looked light. It was a very rich cake with a lot of flavour, very floral, and a great balance with the grapefruit.
Yeah.
Then we get to John. Now, we didn't get to mention a lot of John in this, but let's just say, when John put the fondant over the top, I was like, this is not going to look good. Then when he put the little panels of yellow fondant over the green, I was like, that's not looking great.
No.
Then by the time he finished sitting there and cutting every single one of those tiles and then covering them over and glazing them,
it was a
it was pineapple.
Yep. That's an illusion cake.
It was unbelievable. The quality on that was just incredible. They said it looked absolutely amazing. The detail level was insane. And Kyla even said, the fact you would have had to have sat there and cut every single one of those by hand is insane. Very even layers. The compote was great.
What do you have to do? Snip, snap, snip, snap.
Snip, snap, snip, snap. The compote was great. The rum was definitely there. And as Bruno said, it does feel like a vacation in Hawaii. So he got his vacation. Yes. John, unsurprisingly, is Star Baker this week. And very well deserved. That illusion cake was sensational.
Yes. One little highlight for me was the little note that they gave on Rosie's chocolate petals.
Yep.
Like, I'm thinking that they were just like icing, but you know, snap.
Then when it snapped, they were like, no, that was brilliant. It was surprising.
Good tempering in a hot tent.
Now, Bruno said it best after the judging here, where they unfortunately had to send Jomar home. And they had to send Jomar home. And as Bruno said, look, Jomar didn't do anything wrong.
No.
This week, he goes, this gives you an idea of the level, and we talk about it all the time. The level of competition is somebody had to go.
Yeah.
Jomar, that imbalance probably is what cost him in the end, and being last in the technical probably is the thing that did him in.
And having an underbaked signature.
But as Bruno said, he can be proud of every single thing that he put forward. And you could see especially that connection with the background that he has with Anne as well was really important. Like when, you know,
speaking tag when
she,
together.
And she was, you know, like, when she thanked him. Where is he? Thank you. She goes, no, thank you. Yeah. And it's this, again, absolutely brilliant. He talked about that idea of getting more Filipino stuff out there, which is, again, you know, I hope it does. I mean, there's a fair bit around, obviously, Australia's got a lot more probably visibility of that here because of, again, our proximity to...
Well, you go to Perth, and I think it's quicker to fly to the Philippines from Perth than it is to fly to Sydney.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, it's quicker to go to South Africa, definitely, but...
Oh, then it'd be differently.
Definitely. There's all the help. All the help.
You could go to Johannesburg as well. Anyway.
But why would you? Anyway, so to go on their version of Bake Off and have someone do it all for you. But sad to see Jomar go. Now, obviously, next week, hopefully, I'm not going to promise too much, but next week, hopefully, we might have a few podcasts coming out. Not saying too much, but just suggesting there might be a
touch
bit more.
Wood.
Touch wood. And also, just for those people who have, if you haven't seen the last series of Great Australian Bake Off, find it by whatever means you can and watch it, because in the next week or so, maybe the next 2 weeks, we will be rolling up at a very special venue for Australian Baking's Night of Nights. The Virgies. So the Virgies, Australian Bake Off's Night of Nights, it will obviously happen. And then
my voice so I can do some Carrie Ann Kennelly work.
And then Canadians, it will be your turn at the end of this series, obviously, because, you know, we have to award for the finest in baking. It's our duty.
We've sworn an oath.
Yep.
On the Queen's life.
On the Queen's life, and that went badly. Not poor Lizzie. She was rich.
She was very rich, and
she was rich and paid no tax for most of her life.
That's true. Yeah, there was nothing about poor
Lizzie. She owns swans. Anyway.
She can eat them too, the month. Well,
not anymore. So with that in mind, and knowing that Camilla can go to bed eating swan, I'm still Chris.
I'm still Christy.
And we'll catch you all later.
Don't eat me, Camilla!